what you want to know about. But he's going to use it for some practical purposes, and I hope maybe we can get up into the dozens, or perhaps even the triple digits. So that would make me feel more important. The other point is that what I had mentioned to some of the geometers that he was coming to talk at my conference, their jaw sort of dropped and said, well, we invited him to our geometry conference and he didn't come. So I felt really boosted my stature in the department that he would accept the invitation. So those are two things which I was very happy about. I should also mention the standard math genius kind of things, like the Fields Medal, the Harvard Foundation Fellowship, the Steele Prize, the Shaw Prize. I was very interested to see the Westinghouse Science Talent Finals. So maybe you could tell me what you did, because we just finished Science Fair Weekend, my son's in fourth grade, and he had a really great project, I thought, the Stroop Effect, which if you just fixed it up a little bit, would be a PhD thesis. But he lost to this kid who put radish seeds in a microwave and seemed to germinate afterwards. And I'm pulling my hair out. Well, everything is really quite stellar. I mean, I was searching for some dirt, but the only thing I could come up with was you taught a course at Brown, I guess. And they had published, they put the student reviews on the internet, which they shouldn't do. But it says something, the reviewers felt Professor Mumford was extremely enthusiastic about his course's goal and tried hard to convey his interest in math and to reach the students. However, his lectures were received somewhat negatively. Class members said that Professor Mumford was disorganized and often had to rush to get through all of his course material. Some students found his lectures confusing. I'm not sure if we really should have invited him. Or is it a case of maybe casting Indra's pearls before swan? Yes. Perhaps a little bit closer. But in any case, we'll give you a shot to review. Thank you.
Where people are being scanned for in every conceivable mode, in every conceivable unsuitable posture and uncomfortable procedures. So there's people are swamped with this data, and radiologists would love to have computers assist them in saying, that looks like an abnormal heart. The shape is distinctly bulging out here, or the wall here, or something like that. And so it's the analysis of three-dimensional shapes from scans, which is the big application, actually, there's plenty of funding too, for this computer vision work on shape. So for the last 4 years or so, I've been studying shape with different points of view, and two-dimensional shapes are a heck of a lot easier to understand than three-dimensional shapes. So in any case, this talks about the two-dimensional situation. So I use this script, as always, in the space of simple closed curves. And I'm not specifying how smooth these are. So let's, the particular curve would be C, and it's the boundary of the region R. And I find this an interesting space because it seems to me it's really sort of the natural, just like the easy model is used for everyone that does physical mechanics. It's fundamentally non-linear. It's a manifold. So, by the way, again, I'm going to offend people that think of fractal-type curves. So I think of smooth curves as being the core of this space, C-infinity curves. And then you can complete this space in various metrics and get more complex curves. But in any case, for a curve, you could push it normal to itself. So normal vector fields along the curve and form the tangent space to this manifold everywhere. However, it's a topological. For instance, if you take some smoothness on the curves, like some Sawalf or CK, you can find it's a topological bond on the manifold, but it's not a differentiable bond on the manifold. I don't want to go into that. It's an issue anyway, this being really nonlinear in some sense. Okay. In complex analysis, I think the thrust is always to look at the most general curves in which some particular theorem holds, and to try to analyze exactly how bad the boundary can be. And of course, Klein groups give you incredibly practical boundaries, as you can see my coffee table book, that I think is gross, made by Carolyn Sears. Now the questions so that we ask in computer vision are, when is this shape similar to that shape? And if you take a man on the street and you give him two pictures of contours, say black inside, white outside, and say these similar, they don't consider that to be an absurd question. They'll not, if you give them three and I say these two are similar and it's different than that one. So there's a kind of a psychophysical notion of similarity of shape. What is this anthropomorphic of that? Then, as I say, you want probability measures in order to look at likelihoods that something that you're observing belongs to some category. And as I say, human beings have a tremendous tendency to label things. So they like to label a five-pointed star, a dumbbell, or something like that. So you have categories, and that suggests that there should be cell decompositions of this big space which reflect these categories. All right. Now, okay, so I've said some of this already. You have the invariance of this space. From some points of view, you want to look at inversions instead of embeddings. We saw exactly in Chris's talk that with his retraction circle went through immersions, possibly. Often you want to mod out S by some kind of affine, some part of the affine doing translation. Maybe everything in the relation to the scaling. You can put degrees of smoothness on it. And then there are approaches to the space which use submersion. So from a Riemannian perspective, you can take a mapping of S1 into R2, and say it's an embedding, then the image is going to be the curve, and you'll have an interior. Or you can have the Hawkinson group of R2 act on the unit circle, and that way it would represent S as a homogeneous space. So these approaches can be used to study S from a differential geometric perspective and put structure on S. But this talk wants to focus really on the conformal potential theoretic approaches. Now, so one construction, which is again, came up in the case of the medial axes, I want to point out that medial axes, as far as I know, were first here in the literature from a mathematical biologist named Bloom. Who said this should be is the natural way to describe shapes. And it's become an extremely common tool in computer vision. So there on the left you can see how for all those other recognizable shapes, tracing the medial axis, the locus of centers of bitangent circles. Yeah.
This one side comment. That work was built in the 60s, but there is a 1945 paper third which considers the set of points which are equidistant from two or more boundary points, and prove that that has also initial one. He didn't call it the axis. Call it M2.
I see, but computer vision will know how to pronounce it. Right. So,
so just, he has enough stuff named after him. Yeah. A couple hundred papers. Just in fairness.
So this is supposed to also point out on the right there that if you have the bitangent circles, but so any bitangent circle meets the boundary in two points, which you can join by a straight line, or perhaps a curved line under the various options here. But you get this, you get a kind of a lamination of the interior. So you have this family of lines, whether they're circular or straight, and occasionally you get a tritangent circle, and then that will triangle, and that also just appeared in Chris's talk. But this is the structure that goes along with the medial axis. You get n points with a lantern to nothing, and you get this quadrilateral. But, okay, these particular ones in Stanley, a student of mine, some kind of Jew, hopefully, but he had a stochastic model to produce random shapes, but he could educate this model, and he learned the parameters of the model by training it on animals, and then he sampled from this model. So these are pseudo animals that have the same statistics, from certain statistics as natural animals. Again, this sort of came up, the bottom part, the hyperbolic version. But let me point out, it's actually just as easy to think of it in the Euclidean way. So if you have a curve in the plane, any curve at all, you can take stereographic projection of the two spheres of the plane, lift the curve up by stereographic projection, so it's now on a two sphere, and take its convex hull. Now, I know when I first read Thurston's notes, I just could not visualize these convex hulls. It drove me nuts. I have to come back to this, but I went to some pains a few days ago. I wanted to draw what these convex hulls look like, because it's in three space. So there's, on the left is the plane curve, and I've got the corresponding points for bitangent circles are drawn in. And now I've lifted it, although it may not be entirely clear, that's actually on a two-sphere. It's this curve on the left, lifted by stereographic projection. And now you can see how that convex hull, what it looks like in three space. So it's got some flat angular faces, and then it has places where it has these rulings. Now it's a developable surface, like any convex hull or curve. It's got to give you a developable surface. So it has always one of them. At any given point, there's a ruling, and then this has a fixed tangent plane along that ruling. And as you move along the lamination, the tangent plane twists. And then occasionally it hits the triangle or something like that, and it stops, and then it can go and turn in different directions. So I hope this picture makes the geometry of these convex hulls easier to understand, because this is key to a lot of this talk. So, okay. You can connect the idea of the convex hull to the original bi-tangent circle construction in a very simple way. So if you have the curve in the sphere, okay, so imagine here's a ball, and I've lifted my curve up to a spherographic projection. Now, if I have a hyperplane on one side, it encompasses the sphere in a circle, which under stereographic projection is just a circle downstairs of the plane. Now, if it's below the curve, it'll wind up as a circle inside the original curve. If you move that plane until it touches the curve, it'll become down in the plane a tangent circle. If it touches it twice, it's going to be a supporting hyperplane. It'll touch the circle downstairs in two places. It'll be a bitangent circle. So these bottom supporting planes are 1-1 with the bitangent circles, with the points of the axis, and with the rulings on the convex hull. So one thing that's a little confusing about this construction is that you have the same set coming up, appearing in four different guises here. And now even more, if you go to the hyperbolic version, which Chris talked about, and instead we look at the plane as being the boundary of hyperbolic space up here, and now we erect the hyperbolic plane, which is now a hemisphere, over a circle, and we take, again, the convex hull now in hyperbolic space. Its boundary is going to be this envelope of all of these domes, these hemispheres, and that forms this dome, which you showed in the pictures. And now, you see, the rulings are going to be hoops that go up through the dome. Yeah, you can go through the picture. All right, let's see. Players from complex analysis. Okay, so these are so we've got, I want to talk about the Riemann map from, I don't know, who's the guy gold. That D is a disk, the interior R of the shape. And there's also a map on the exterior of the disk to the exterior of our curve, including the point of infinity. And then you have the welding map, which I understand some people feel could be called the sawing map or the gluing map, but in any case, what can you say about the interior and exterior map? One thing you can say is that they're both curve is smooth, going to be defined on the boundary. So you can take the boundary of the disk, go forward by the interior map to our curve, go backwards by the exterior map, and that's called the welding map. And we'll talk a little bit later about let's introduce it at this point. The main point is the beauty of it is this amazing result, which I guess is first published by Kirillov, that this creates a diffeomorphism. A bijection, diffeomorphism. I don't say homeomorphism because I'm really focused on smooth curves, smooth maps. So I say diffeomorphisms of the circle, that's the C. Notice that C is not completely well determined because when I look at the Riemann mapping, I have a Möbius map on the right. I can take any submap of the disk and I have an equally good Riemann mapping. C minus is really only determined up to the right multiplication by Möbius map. B plus is really rigid because it's going to map infinity to infinity, and that's because it's not positive real axis in the cycle. So B plus is really B minus, isn't it? So it's a homogeneous space, a one-sided coset space. And if you work it out, it's a bijection with S mod translation scaling. That's a brief description of what the welding map is. And the other player is the lamination given by these maximal the bitangent circles. Here I've made it circular arcs perpendicular to the two boundaries. And Chris was talking at some length about this in Zyoto map, which contracts well, you can run it either way. It's contracting R to D. You can also run it the other way.
Well,
the remarkable theorem is it's a bijection.
Okay.
Do I have a laser
pointer?
You can recover the curve. So in other words, here we go. So I'm giving you the construction that goes from the curve to C. But from C, Well, it's the construction is simple enough, right? You just take a hemisphere here and hemisphere here, both by the circles of boundary, and I weld them by C, and so you have a simply connected compact Riemann surface. It's got to be the two-sphere, and when you make the two-sphere, lo and behold, the equator becomes the curve C. So you recover the curve C. All right. Now, first of all, since it was a computational thing, I thought this, I ought to put this first. So welding, I like welding, and we wanted weld, and we wanted to do a lot of welding in order to be able to connect what we're doing in computer vision with actual curves. Yeah.
I mean, I think the word remarkable there is that you're really using the value of practice. Well, you're using the pieces together. You really don't have a real curve structure in common.
That's true.
About there's a unique component structure.
Yeah.
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 Like that.
Yeah, well that, but that's a 19th century result, so
I think it's remarkable.
It's very remarkable, but it's all remarkable. So a lot of this conference is centered around the fact that the Riemann mapping is incredibly hard to compute and has all sorts of, especially to compute it accurately and compute it accurately in case of air crowding. I want to propose that the welding, which is going the other direction, is actually much simpler to compute. And I didn't realize this before. I struggled with boundary value problems and stuff with my postdoc, Eitan Sharon. But in fact, if you use the Hilbert transform, it's pretty simple. Because you see, if you look at the, this was the interior Riemann mapping. And let's assume that f of the interior takes 0 to 0 for simplicity. Then that's going to be a nice power series like this because of the whole Mumford mapping. On the other hand, the exterior mapping takes infinity to infinity, and you can expand it this way as a Laurent series, holomorphic outside of this. Now, the point is, so there's a periodic Hilbert transform. Instead of convolving with 1 over x like you do in the line, you could involve the cotangent theta over 2, which in the origin is like theta. A little bit of painful analysis will show you that it's like the Hilbert transform effect on the Fourier series, which is precisely multiplied by I times the sine of n. So if you kill the constant term and multiply the positive term by I, the negative. I don't know, there could be a sign wrong or a two wrong in this one. I did not stake my life. But you see, you can easily see what's happening here. What are the conditions? The conditions on these two functions are expressed immediately by the Hilbert transform. You see, because this guy is going to be multiplied by I. Here's the bottom line down here. The bottom line is that if you hit, so we have this. This is the connection. F plus composed with C is F minus. So if I take the Hilbert transform of F plus composed with C, I get F minus. The Hilbert transform does this, and then I substitute that. So it means that this guy, if I put a C inverse there, takes this to minus itself. Now, on F plus, however, it multiplies all of this by minus I, but multiplies this by plus I. So the net result is that the Hilbert transform conjugated by composition with C minus the Hilbert transform itself is minus 2. Now, so you have this. See, the nice thing is the Hilbert transform is a singular integral transform, but this difference is a nice regular integral transform because it kills the poles of the kernel. So that's the point. This difference here, the early fact, is composition of the smooth kernel, see immediately that F plus is obtained by a nice integral equation of the classical type, and it's even nicer because there's an I there. So you have this very, very simple equation. And here is the entire MATLAB code. Actually, the entire thing. There's a certain amount of interpolation to half grid points, and what you really want to do, because it's a singular kernel, you want to integrate it between grid points rather than take its values. That's smoother. And sine log, yeah, log sine is the integral. So that's like a log and sine. This is the nice smooth kernel. And then you solve it by inverting the matrix, as we mentioned back with slash, inverting the matrix. So anyway, this almost like a charm.
What? The problem are you solving?
I'm solving the problem of welding. So I'm given the different moment of the circle, and I want to find the curve. So all I have to do is
put out here.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, so I just...
There's a power series.
I just evaluate this. This F is a vector here. It's the value on the sample of points on the perimeter of the circle. It doesn't have to be uniform in space, Gavin. So this solves for the values of the Riemann map on any discrete sample on the circle. So you just make the image and reject the perimeter. The only trick is you've got to be a little careful to really get the fact that you're getting a smooth kernel. At first I did it without consideration business and it was so-so. And then, at this point, it seems to work really, really well.
What happens is you asked the question the previous time, what happened was on
the exactly. It's true. I haven't tested it on really nasty, elongated things. What I am doing is, I'm actually not taking a single phi. What I've been doing generally is I take uniform spacing of grid points on the curve and go back to the corresponding points on the line, and then I give the diffeomorphism. I have an interior and exterior mapping, so I give the diffeomorphism as the composition of one of these phi's on the inverse of the other. Essentially parameterizing the graph of the diffeomorphism by sample points, which aren't uniform. So if you have a very high derivative, your sample points are tremendously close in one coordinate and move fast in the other coordinate, vice versa. So this has been enough to solve some of the very first crowding. But if you have multiple crowding on top of itself, I'm sure this will fail. And I think adapting this to really, I don't know. That's an interesting question. Suggested, and I was skeptical at first, but now I think, maybe this is one can think of the solving for the Riemann also this way. Namely, suppose this is the boundary of Riemann mapping with the disk to the interior of C. Now, you could say, what you could do is look at log of the derivative of this, and look at the real and imaginary parts of log of the derivative. Now, they have to be Hilbert transforms of each other. Now, the imaginary part of log of the derivative is just given by the orientation of the curve, and the orientation of the circle. So that's the imaginary part of log of the derivative. And then you have the real part of the log of the derivative. This is now a mapping here to here. It has a derivative just in terms of theta here and r point here. So it has a derivative. And so you can ask that these should be Hilbert transforms of each other. This is not obviously a complete proposal for an algorithm, but it could be a starting point of some sort of relaxation method. Highly nonlinear. If you try to make these equal to each other, maybe by some iteration, perhaps it converges, maybe you want to try to do some gradient descent on the difference of these. So you can,
it's not unrelated to Schwarz-Christoffel.
Based on free series, starting with parameterization curve, and then changing its free series, all the coefficients are negative, zero to negative, as an iterative method.
It's
not for
loop-like method.
Yeah, you start with some smooth parameterization, so then you try to force all the negative coefficients back.
But it could be closed in terms of the global curve.
Okay, let me get into some. So what I'm going to propose now is a new definition of an axis and a whole new approach to an axis, a modification of physics, earthquake theorem, and a cell decomposition of the spaces attached to this. So let's first start with the, so here are our two curves and the Riemann parameterization of the interior and the exterior. And it's quite clear, just look at the interior mapping, that what's happening is that first the derivative gets large at a point, so P0 is the image of the origin. P is a point on the boundary here. So the derivative gets large when you're far, like here. It also gets far if the curvature becomes large in a positive sense, large positive x. On the other hand, the derivative gets small if you're close to P0, or even smaller if you're concave at those points, so kappa is large negative. So we have these two factors apparently. And one of the things which I thought was quite interesting was to try to quantify this effect. And so Matt has been working on this. And I talked to a lot of people doing univalent functions, and they have an incredible number of theorems saying if this holds, then the Riemann mapping has a positive derivative at this point on the boundary. But they don't. They don't give you explicit bounds. I think the focus in entire literature, going back to Warshawski and people, is just theorem saying such and such is non-zero, such and such is this. But how about to be bound? Okay. All right. So our proposal is this. So this is the Riemann mapping from a disk to the interior of some curve. We want to assume that the origin does go somewhere in the middle. So we assume it's on the medial axis. And we assume we have some boundary point where we want to get the boundary derivative. So actually, this goes back to S1, and this evaluates the derivative. I guess it's P inverse. Okay, now what we want to do is to take then the bitangent circle in the region at the boundary point. So there's C, here's the bitangent circle. This is the other map. Say here was P0. And we want to think of this as coming from two factors. If this is far from here and what's happening locally because of the curvature here. So the idea is to is the factor P in the Möbius map and another Riemann mapping where the new one maps 0 to the middle of this circle to somewhere here. So then the derivative, of course, will be the product of the derivative here and the derivative here. The derivative of this factor here, so that's the first point, can be estimated in terms of kind of a distance along the medial axis from one point to the other. It seems that using Sullivan's theorem, coming up for the 20th time today, get upper and lower, we get two constants, so giving upper and lower bounds, which are then exponentials of this. You need to integrate along the medial axis, one over the radius of the circles in the medial axis.
A similar thing is known with the name of the alpha distortion.
Okay, yeah, I'm not surprised, but yeah, I really want. Now, how about this one? Because this is actually I really want to put this up here because maybe some experts have seen this. But the issue now is once you get near the boundary, so it is P0 and here's your boundary point, there's a lot of work on how nasty the boundary can be to get a non-zero derivative at the boundary. The upper bound is not trivial because the circle this is the center, it's inside the domain. But the lower bound is not at all trivial. So this is the lower bound, this may not be right. This is the lower bound associated with the oscillating circle. The boundary is actually a circle. Kappa is the curvature of the boundary. And you see as kappa goes to minus infinity, this goes to zero, and indeed, this will should go to zero in that case. But then there's a correction term having to do with exactly how far the boundary is from its oscillating circle. So I think it's a nice theorem, and I don't know if something like this is known, and of course, Matt is also here tonight. That's how he's using it. It does it by extreme length. Yeah, that's the method. Right. Okay. Anyway, now here's the first bit of definition on one end. So going back to this, let me go back to there. What are the characteristics of the middle from a potential theoretic point of view? I mean, we have bi-tangent circles. That's a crude geometric measure of the middle of the shape. What is the middle of the shape from the point of view of electrostatic potentials? It's places in here. You see, at this point, the electric fields, you see, you're going to have the, if I put a charge there, I'm going to have the biggest normal derivative here and here for that charge. They're the electrostatically closest in here. So I'm going to have 2 points here where V prime has equal minimum. See, it's a very closely spaced level images of those radii, so radial prime. So it means that these run very slowly. So I have 2 equal minima with V prime. Well, see, that can be used, in fact, it can be used in n dimensions to define a medial structure in a shape from a sort of potential theoretic point of view. We ask for the points inside the region with a property. If the Riemann mapping takes 0 to that point, then there should be 2 equal global minima to P prime. Now, the same thing can be done in higher dimensions using the Green's kernel attached to the Laplacian with Dirichlet boundary conditions. You can ask again that this the normal derivative here has Q. P. P. No, I had it. It's the same condition as here, but done in terms of this Green's kernel. There's 2 equal minima. But this is going to be some sort of scaffold type structure in the center of the shape. Okay.
This question is a minimum.
No, I mean minimum. You're absolutely right. This should be maximum. This is minimum. It's a 70 P prime minimum.
No, it's minimum. It's minimum.
This coloring is the ratio of the two of the global minimum and the nearest local minimum, showing how it peaks. And the dumbbell, this actually shows it more clearly. Here's the axis, and now we've shown you where the minima are. And now what's happening is, because of the concavity here, these lines are attracted to here, and likewise, this would be electrostatically closer here. I guess we see it here, yeah. So these points here, look at this guy. See, what's happening with these is it's the tip and some point along here, which are sort of an equal distance from the points along here. anyway, the axis does it. So it's not exactly the same as the medial axis. But we'll see later, we'll compare it. We'll see. In many cases, it's very close to the medial axis. In many cases, it's the same. All right.
Yeah, now this is also coming from a convex hull.
So this is the second key point there. I want to lift my contour into this cone. This is like a positive right cone, like this. And I want to take the derivative of phi times cosine and sine of 1. So this squared with this root is that. So it's on this surface. And take its convex hull. And the reason is precisely that when you change phi by omega to f and apply it on a inverse of a fixed point, it's easy, it's small calculation, that it multiplies it by this. The net result of this little lemma is that this convex, that this medial axis, this axis is also gotten by a convex hull. Now, this gets a little tricky to think about, but you see, the rulings on the bottom of the convex hull run by supporting hyperplanes below it, which needed at two points. And now the supporting hyperplanes are going to have equations like this, lambda x plus mu y plus mu z. And if I restrict it to these points, the linear function on c tilde will have this form. And so having a supporting hyperplane below it meeting it twice will mean this has two global minima. So go back and forth. And that gives another way. All right. Now this particular construction, I want to propose, seems to me to come from a general perspective. So one of Thurston's most beautiful theorems was this so-called earthquake theorem, which gave you a way of describing suitable coupling coefficients of S1, modulo Mobius maps, by measuring laminations. So I don't want to recall that. This is all based on, in some sense, saying that isothermorphism is sort of a continuous composition of hyperbolic maps. But I believe that this other construction shows that gives a way of representing suitable homeomorphisms as continuous compositions of elliptic maps. What I said in the previous slide more generally says I can start with any homeomorphism of S1, B, form this curve in the cone, take its convex hull. Now the convex hull gives you a lamination. Namely, I have the rulings on the convex hull, these line segments spanning from the circle to the circle. That gives you a lamination. But what is a ruling? How do you produce a developable surface in three space? Here's the way to visualize it. You have a surface, and it has a line on it. Along that line, there's a common tangent plane. Now, what happens infinitesimally when you move to the nearby ruling is the nearby ruling rotates a tiny amount, and then the tangent plane bends. It rotates around the ruling. So the ruling moves, the ruling rotates in the tangent plane, then the tangent plane rotates around the ruling. And that's how any developable surface is created. Now, the lamination tells you how much rotation there is of the ruling in the plane, and the bending, what this calls the bending, determines how much the tangent plane rotates around the ruling. And you can convert this into an ODE, and you can see that you can go backwards from the bending lamination to produce, to reconstruct phi prime. Some technicalities here, the D's that in there, roughly speaking, it's very similar. And you see, I think what's interesting about it is any time you have two things being isomorphic, it's much more interesting than having a math and one together. And it's really telling you, it's giving you another perspective on a group of homeomorphisms.
I say is roughly that diffeomorphisms are produced by a continuous integration of elliptic infinitesimal elliptic mass. If you're a MATLAB genius, you know how to do lighting MATLAB maps. This is the best I can do. I tried to I've drawn the light from upside down and I tried to draw what these developable surfaces look like. So here there's a flat face, and here it begins rotating, there's another flat face there, and it rotates somewhere down to here. It's not fully successful. Now, first of all, these axes, it turns out you can connect the two. If you apply this to the Yoda map, gives you the medial axis back. You see, so let me run through this real quick. If you start with any map of the disk or a region, the boundary gives you a diffeomorphism. This is the C of the boundary and scale of it. And hence you get a lamination from the double tenement of this, and hence you get an axis on the locus of these points, and you get a measure. Now, in case, see, there's a Riemann map, we saw at the beginning, this is the conformal axis. If C is the, that is the inverse of the area, we get back the medial axis. We haven't checked all the details, the bending must be the same. So it's a general construction which incorporates the others. I'm sorry, it's an awful lot of players.
Yeah. One thing I might mention about the other map is that once you fix a base disk and you do the retraction back into this base disk, if you look at it as a map from the boundary or shape of the boundary of the disk, the derivative is always one of that map at fixed points. And so those end up being one thing about using that is that the C for computing. The Riemann map, you can think of it as a Riemann map, because it's completely blind to the
boundary. By the way, I don't know if anyone, it's in the literature anywhere, to work out the from a differential geometric perspective, the Yoda map for smooth curves. And we don't know, and as formulas like this, to do the differential geometry of this. Because reducing to a finite union of circles is the standard method instead of reducing to the smooth case. But the differential geometry is very nice. Okay, so now finally the last definition. So now I want to say, measured laminations break up very naturally into cells. Namely, you have something generic laminations, which are levels which have a finite number of triangles in them, and the rest are 1D laminates. So you have, in the case we've been talking about, you have only a finite number of tri-tangent surfaces. Everything else is a bi-tangent surface. In that case, there's a graph associated to this, because we have put a vertex for each tri-tangent circle, an edge for each family of one-dimensional lamina, an endpoint when the lamina shrinks to nothing. And you can even, these don't cover the whole space. You can make them cover, I hope, by sort of shrinking the lamination a little bit, by throwing out a little nonsense. These medial axes tend to have a lot of fuzz on them, so just to tear the nasty, small sorts of things and tiny little slivery triangles, which are really a pain in the neck. So hopefully you can sort of throw them out with some excellent lamination, and that way cover the entire space. But so I think there's an actual sort of cell decomposition here. So finally, let's try to put this together with S, the space of shapes. Now, yes, so we did, we talked about this a while back. Shapes, quantum translation scaling, and notations are like the diffeomorphisms called SL2, and I threw in the rotations here. So I could compare it now to this, the bijection. So in this situation, the cell decomposition becomes a cell decomposition over here. You can also do it simply with the Riemann mapping by itself, but just like in Chris's talk, the problem with looking at the Riemann map is that when you do anything to it, play games with it, it tends to become immersed and not embedded. Because it, you see, if I have the Riemann mapping and I look at the at its right as a map from S1 to S1, so I restrict it to the boundary and parameterize it by scale argmax, I get a map from S1 to S1. That determines the shape, simply because this is its derivative, log of derivative is the real part of the scale dimension part. So this is injected. That is not in the least bit surjective. So this is a nasty subset of this, and you try to do natural things inside here, and you go out of it. So you can extend this mapping from the actual embedded curves to embedded domain, immersed domains that go across. So, for that especially distance, nicer. Let's see. So I wanted to show you, so we can use the welding map itself to get an axis. So, actually, here's some of the welding maps that they look like. So here's this, the shape's not here anymore, so I'll never do that. That's the top one, it's the ellipse. But anyway, this is what I want to show you. So here's a comparison of axes from different perspectives. So we have on these the medial, the bigger, which is the welding axis, the one from the interior Riemann mapping, and the atlas, but where you take the product of the derivatives of the inside and outside. So you get somewhat different axes from these constructions. And so actually this product is rather wild. But notice how, so in this case, the medial axis and the conformal and the interior axis are extremely close to each other. Here they begin to diverge. There's this one and this one. Which is the medial? Oh, where's the medial axis? Oh, we don't have the medial axis on the medial. Okay. So we have these axes. Now, here's, just to finish up. Here, this is from my colleague Ben Kimia, who's so he was studying fish. Fish are great from a computer vision perspective because they have a very natural two-dimensional contour, a canonical viewpoint. And you can see how as the fins vary. In this case, the axis comes with some labels on them too, and you can see that. It goes to a point here where there's a sort of a bifurcation from one order to the other order. So you can break up the collection of fish into the cells, and I don't know actually how to do this figure. Studying, trying to classify fish and using this cell decomposition. It's really just a proof of this that is there. And, one last thing about the well. Which I think is really important. That is that, you see, diffeomorphisms is a group. Shapes don't seem to be a group, but you see, you get a multi-value composition law. So here I've taken a shape plus a base point in the interior. And in that case, this is like a double process. So fixing the base point reduces the indeterminacy down to the rotation group there. So I have double process among rotations. Now here, I can get a multi-value composition, which is a variable rotation in the middle. So if I want to compose two of these, I have a one-dimensional family of compositions. Or another way to put it is, if you want a unique composition of two shapes, all I need to do is to fix a base point in the first factor and a relative having a group of any kind in something so ungroup-like as the set of simple closed curves, I think it's kind of fascinating. And it suggests that things like the Cayley graph of the diffeomorphism group should be looked at, and one should have it like a continuous Cayley graph in which the rotations are all sort of bundled together as one sort of group of clusters, things in this interdimensional space. And I think this suggests the possibility of a combinatorial understanding of this group under composition. So I want to suggest that it's like, so here's an experiment. This is a lot of fun. So we've taken two shapes. First was this boomerang that we had before. The second shape is just an elongated strip. And we've asked what happens when we multiply each other. Well, here's how it goes. Here is the diffeomorphism associated with the boomerang shape. That's the welding diffeomorphism, exactly. So these two steep places are the two endpoints here, with a very large derivative. And let's see, so there's a horizontal thing here, and a not quite so horizontal thing here. The really horizontal thing would be there, which is the closest thing. This would be this is the welding map associated to simply a long strip. It's got nearby things where it's across linear and stream. Oh yeah, I put the image of the origin at one end in the middle of the circle. So there'll be a long area where it's like a circle and the welding map goes linearly. And then this big thing going up there has a very, very high derivative here. Now, here are two ways to weld them. Depending on, here's the composition, for instance. This one followed by this one, so it's stretched out this very rapidly. And depending on how extreme the elongation is in the cigar, so here you see you get these wrenches, you get the basic boomerang shape, but depending upon the rotation, which is where this thing is put into that graph, the handle of the wrench takes the boomerang and builds the thing off in different directions. And here, however, the boomerang is the dominant one, and it just produces a lump on the boomerang that, as you see, as you move around, the lump goes here, it goes down around, goes to the bottom tip, moves around the side, moves through the middle rather fast, moves up around the top and so on. So you can see, it's intuitively, it's a lot of operation that you want to have some interesting theory connected to it. So, okay. I think that there's a lot of interesting tools here, which from complex analysis, which were applicable to the spool shapes as well as the master shapes. There's a whole other set of ideas connected to the Vane-Peterson metric and the geodesics. The Vane-Peterson metric makes the space of shapes as into a homogeneous manifold. That's the Vane-Peterson property. I mean, to put a homogeneous metric, Riemannian metric, on this. Shapes don't look at least in homogeneous, but this somehow makes them metrically a homogeneous space. So we've been working on trying to get a decent way to compute geodesics, for instance. That's really decent, which is not so simple. Some of the soliton crowd was very enthusiastic that maybe it was a completely integrable system with the Vane-Peterson method and geodesics in this space.
You need the Vane-Peterson method. Where's
that? In the universal Teichmüller space. So it's very readily defined if we go back. We just take the slides down here. Okay. So, all right. So here, the time and space here is, of course, the origin are vector fields in a circle. The time and space to this are the vector fields of the 0 plus minus 1 coefficients. So I just put the inner product on the vector fields, which is the sum of the Fourier coefficients times this magic coefficient, n cubed minus n, which makes it invariant under the adjunct representation here. And then you smear it around, and it produces an invariant vector. Are smooth. I was actually assuming the curves were generic. I set up a nice ODE when we construct the curve. So yeah, clearly the stem, one should try to push it further, and that's going to require more serious tools for dealing with it. Yeah. It seems to be quite reasonable to assume that we'll probably generalize some suitable class of curves. No, it's a theorem for smooth curves. I know I can prove for the generic, the medial axis, the lamination is generic. I can show how to reconstruct B by an ODE.
So what I mean, in order to have the ODE, to have the resistance solution for ODE, maybe there needs some conditions.
Okay. So what I'm sure is true is that there's a bijection between suitably generic measured laminations and suitably generic Living Walkers. Via bending. How to extend this to the most general case?